Nobody should have to live like this.
This is not home.
Wrong place, wrong time.
I have two children and I'm pregnant. I'm hungry and I can't get the Winn-Dixie.
The Red Cross does less during a disaster than it does every other day.
I'm sure that's not what the American public thinks is happening down here.
Everybody should have an eye open now to see exactly how our government is.
Politicians need to be accountable.
Over 10 carloads of police that came in.
And be harassed constantly by the New Orleans police.
They're standing around with their thumb up.
They can arrest you and your rights are totally taken away.
To hell with the blacks.
Is gonna happen in San Francisco when the next earthquake hits.
Like you totally lost, right?
Get the F out of here.
We lost.
He still won rent money.
Hurricane bomb.
They had no respect.
There were no phones.
20% of the population here were left to die.
Please don't help us.
Oh, this was the best block in the night ward. Without a doubt, this was the best block in the night ward. I was just amazed because I didn't think it was going to be this bad. It's hard to lose everything. Oh, I had hardwood floors and I had a trophy case there for my son, trophies. He had a lot of trophies he had won for playing baseball and sports, playing basketball and stuff. This was the kitchen and the living room. And we had it fixed up pretty nice. I had to come by here two or three times before I can clean all this up. Then I'm not sure. We're gonna have to tear this house down. I'm gonna build me a new house and come back home. Same location. There's nowhere else I'd stay other than here. This is home for me.
This was my home. Born and raised in the back room. I raised three daughters and two granddaughters from this home. My mother had six of us, but this is not a home anymore. This is pure devastation. I have a car on my fence. My living room doesn't look like a living room. My dining room oak table is on the floor upside down. I have nothing, nothing. Tears, heartaches, just total destruction, especially from inside. My life was in there. Now I'm homeless. Never been there, never did that. I want to come back here. 3106 Lawset Place. This is where I want to be.
Katrina did hit this area pretty hard, and I feel that Red Cross was wrong for not coming out to this neighborhood, checking it out, and helping us, because we really needed Red Cross help. But Red Cross didn't never come out.
If you see that barrel on my steps, Red Cross, that's what they threw to us 5 days after the storm. Two-year-old expired hard rock candy. They dropped that out the sky. Expired hard rock. Would it make us more thirsty, you think? Huh? Yeah, if we were dumb enough to eat it.
It was given $310 per person, and they gave me $965 for me and my wife and my son.
FEMA's talking about doing something for me, and I hope they do. Like, give me a new home, something I can call home.
Right now, they put us two trailers, and they have, it's been like 8 days. They haven't finished hook it up, I don't know.
Just looking around, we feel like hopeless.
We lost.
They don't come to a small area. If you're in a rich area, you'll be taken care of. In a small poor neighborhood like this, they don't come. And I'm telling you, being honest. They don't do nothing. They always do a little thing, you know, just for the TV, and that's it. I can't work because my job is out of order. But like somebody just took a hand and just, you know, people that struggle and work every day, they don't want to catch the hell, but we the ones spending out all that tax money. See, they don't look at that. Ain't no way we should have go to trial and tribulation just before the government to help us when we paying our tax dollars.
And what happens when the government finally decides they're not going to pay anymore because the American public stops paying attention and stops caring, that these people still don't have a place to live, still don't have access to jobs, still cannot rebuild their lives?
Depend on the government, you might as well shoot yourself. Because ain't nothing that's not going to get done. Depend on the government.
FEMA. Really, all I saw at FEMA was a bunch of clipboard holders and very expensive ones. I didn't see them doing anything. And that's been over a month. Now, they may be doing things in the background or for people that have more money and more property, but they're certainly not having any boots on the ground.
It was very obvious what was going on down here. And I felt as though if I didn't come, I had to peel my black skin off and turn it in. You know, I had to come down here and see about my people. My first intention was just to come down here and drop off relief, pick up as many black people as I could in my truck, turn around and go back to Western North Carolina. At least they'd be out of the line of fire. There's madness. They told me about my link Raheem, a former Panther, who was trying to get a health clinic set up down here. The brother's spirit was really strong and really clean, you know. And that's what really like made me stay and make the commitment and everything, because I felt as though through his leadership, things could really happen, you know.
I spent the last 35 years of my life in the struggle for peace and justice. I founded and operated community centers here in New Orleans and in other places, but particularly in New Orleans. Common Ground derives from the work that we was doing, and it's not a traditional in-the-box organizational structure. It's one that is constantly evolving.
Now these are some good buckets for the mop, and I'm telling y'all.
In a month and a half, we probably done distributed over, I would say close to about $1.5 to $1.8 million worth of supplies. Served over 16,000 people. I don't believe no one envisioned this. It just took the life of its own.
Having the activists and the organizers come here and getting it together with them and setting up a model that's working very well, and we're effectively pulling resources from humanitarian groups and aiding the poor.
If it weren't for this young lady right here, turn around, sir, and another young lady, we wouldn't have no food back here. We wouldn't have nothing. Nobody would have come back here. Nobody.
I take supplies from them and go to poor neighborhoods and give it to poor people. Drove around to some poor neighborhoods that I know of. And we gave them a bunch of free food and water.
This is his he come around. This is second week and he's sure looking out for us.
Yeah.
Cause we really ain't getting no help too much.
Everything on your own, man.
We all appreciate what we get.
We want to thank you for everything that you're doing for everybody back there.
My interest in volunteering is to be effective, not to be a, you know, get a merit badge for being a volunteer at a Red Cross station.
People think they need certain resources or power to help people instead of just spontaneously getting up and going and doing whatever you can.
I came back to start the Ninth Ward project, which I really didn't know what it would be, but I knew that there needed to be a distribution center I knew that the city has been trying for years to take certain parts of the Ninth Ward, so I assumed that they'd be discouraging people from coming back, which is accurate. And the other thing we're doing is there's a lot of the homes here are okay, and we're tarping roofs, and we're pulling out the sheetrock, pulling out the mold, bleaching and cleaning the wood, trying to make it where people's homes are livable and safe. Now, they don't have electricity because the city won't turn it back on. We have generators, not enough to give everyone. So we're trying to make it basically livable to anybody. It's going to be very uncomfortable, but livable.
And I look up in the backyard, and I see people from all over the United States coming here and not going to the Red Cross, not going to FEMA, but coming here, sleeping in tents in some condition that I couldn't sleep in.
We're essentially supporting the supporters, the people who go out and are trying to clean up Ninth Ward, go out, try to help in whatever ways they can. They come home, they need showers, they're filthy, they need an easy existence, as easy as we can make it, so that they can perform what they do. We're all in this together, right? But we're not in this together. We're separated by class, we're separated by race, and the effect of Katrina follows those channels. But just for instance, we have an upper middle class neighborhood right adjacent to this neighborhood, which I would call working class. And they complain because the trash is piled up by the fence. They don't call FEMA, who is supposed to pick up the trash and will not. They call us and complain that it's there, as if the trash created by Katrina was our essential problem, and we should have forklifts to get rid of it. We're talking, you know, a small mountain of trash.
This is one step closer to everybody getting to be able to get their houses back together. Everyone needs a refrigerator up to somebody's house. I've heard 2 months, I've heard 6 months, I don't know how long it's going to last. I'd just be glad when it's all done.
We've done work on hundreds of homes, whether it was just clearing out flooded furniture, doing tree work, or gutting entirely the homes from the flooded walls, and connecting with as many of the owners and former residents as we can to make sure that what they want to happen to their property is what gets done. Thousands of families are trying to balance a full-time job with going and cleaning out their house. The lower Ninth Ward had the highest home ownership rate in the city, people that have lived there for generations. It was a community, it was a neighborhood.
I was watching CNN. They had a little box that was showing the progress of Dow Jones. And while all this madness is going on, Louisiana real estate was number one on the Dow Jones.
The areas that are being targeted for non-rebuilding include the lower Ninth Ward, and they also include almost every other primarily low-income black neighborhood in New Orleans. So in the lower Ninth Ward, since that was the site of tremendous damage, there's a big push to just wipe the whole thing off the face of the earth. The properties that are on the immediate list are tagged because they represent a danger to the public health, that they're in imminent danger of collapse in some way, or that they are impinging upon the public way. And some of these homes that have been moved are actually in incredibly stable condition. They are solid still. They've just been moved in their entirety and could very well be put back on their foundations. And that might be the route that an insurance company would want to take rather than pay out. And it might very well be the route that a homeowner would want to take. It's a hell of a lot easier to put your house back on the slab than it is to toss the whole thing and start all over again. We're preparing to make sure that if people don't want their homes bulldozed, they have someone to stand up for them.
1, 2, 3, 4, let us back into our ward. 5, 6, 7, 8, we don't want to vacate.
There's a series of illegal evictions that are going on where various landlords in the New Orleans area want to take advantage of the fact that there's rising rental prices for their property.
The large case, the complex of Lewisburg Square Apartments, currently all the residents have vacated those apartments. Some of them were legally evicted and some of them were pressured into leaving before they had to, and some apartments were illegally entered and emptied.
The issue of the condition of the apartments or whether the landlord has the right to push those tenants out while they make repairs has not been addressed, so these tenants know they most likely will have to go back to court. That includes tenants like Bertha Duga. They said they tried to pay their rent when they returned to town, but they were told that the rent was refused, and they also were told to vacate their property. The tenants believe they were being forced out to allow the owners to charge higher rents. Those issues were not addressed today in court. The justice of the peace says both sides need to work together during this tough time.
Because the tenants had evacuated for the hurricane and returned and timely tendered the rent, that was a legal defense, and that amounted to acceptance of rent, and that's why we won.
We go with whatever the judge says.
Do you want to evict these tenants?
No comment.
The landlord, Leonard Samia of Massachusetts, he gutted all the buildings down to studs, throwing away everything inside. We actually saw his workers putting aside televisions and bikes and electronics. And those didn't go in the trash piles. Those went off into trailers and they got taken away. He got such bad press that he actually made a statement just recently that he would allow all residents to return to their apartments when the remodel is complete at the same rent.
But the Justice of the Peace, Vernon Rulte, says that if he sees any evidence of landlords taking advantage of tenants or tenants taking advantage of landlords, he'll pass that information on to the Attorney General's office.
We have individuals out here now that's addressing everything from evictions. We're establishing a legal component. That's the reason why we have a health clinic. I had never thought that in my wildest dream that I would have doctors come in to volunteer their time. And if you would take the labor, just the labor costs that it would be if we was paying those health professionals, it would add up into the tens of thousands a day. When you look at medication that is being given away there, the average person can't even afford it. And the government haven't given us nothing.
We've done a lot of routine blood pressure screenings, a lot of blood glucose screenings. We've done emergency care in people's homes. We've provided free herbal medicine. We started an acupuncture program. You don't have to have Medicaid, you don't have to have insurance. You walk in, fill out your form, and at the peak hour when the most people are in there, you wait no more than an hour.
Before Katrina, this community was a greatly underserved community as far as easy, open access style of healthcare where you're tied strongly to the community.
Our first month, we operated on a budget of well under $5,000. The volunteers were not being paid, still aren't being paid. The supplies have gotten sent to us from all over the country for free. The people who started this clinic are all very poor people, but the people who've come in to staff it are often not. So they've all been calling and fundraising from among their friends. We need to pay nurses, we need to pay pharmacists. And that's what we're looking at as a really daunting task for next year, because otherwise the goodwill of the country is going to run out and the clinic's going to disappear.
We need a bigger building. We need a permanent space that we can have to transfer control of this clinic over to the community.
I mean, there's so much just beyond direct medical attention. You know, there's so much integrative medicine going on here that I hope that we've been able to kind of serve them in all their needs. Yeah.
As you all know, right now we don't have any hospitals really to go to. Lots of us don't have transportation to get to certain areas. And with them being here, they can assist us with lots of different things, like the tetanus shot, flu shots, or medication that we need for right now.
If
What it does what FEMA and the Red Cross didn't do in the beginning, and that was on the ground, one of the first organizations, and the only grassroots organization that was first on the ground to serve the people with their needs as far as water, food, diapers. If they needed to register for FEMA, if they needed to register for Red Cross, we had techs that come from all over the country here to set up a computer lab so the people will be able to use the computer lab and everything.
As far as Red Cross goes, they have to do, by dictate, less during a disaster than they do every other day. They work like the military in a triage situation where they treat the least affected first, the ones that could come to them under their own power, the ones that could drive to a food distribution place and pick up food themselves. But there's no outreach, there isn't any internet access for them to sign up at a shelter to get their benefits or even apply to FEMA for disaster relief.
I mean, these groups put up signs saying, oh, call this number for assistance. There were no phones working. How are people gonna call for help? This city barely was computer literate and had large scale computer access before Katrina. How are people gonna go on the internet to file financial aid forms?
They had no respect or any type of love for us at all. Well, they use our images across the world to make this bullshit look legitimate.
The media was portraying that, you know, it was a dangerous place, people were looting, but it was obvious that it was a racist statement when they would say that the black people are looting and the poor tourists were just feeding themselves. So that's just blatantly wrong. Most people that were looted from were black.
As far as you guys can see, that they tore up all the poker machine vandalism, all the way, all my poker machines, about three poker machines is broken. Also, right in the back here, we got also an ATM machine, right over here. And the reason I leave it open, so when the looters come in, they could have seen that it's open. They don't have to break it, but they still tore it up. I also left them a note on my register, which I did left a note, drink as much as you want, no money. You can tell to break up the register, but the looters have looted everything, even though I leave everything here open. So they could have seen that no money, no money was in the place. I gone with all the money. That's the main thing, I took all the money out. But I know somebody had to break the door down for they had leave some marks on there and the date, so somebody came in here. But I don't know who, I know that they had put some red marks. This building was very, very secure. I understand you break the door down, put some kind of security on it. You came in, no dead person, no nothing. Even if it's a lock, you know, something to protect. Just don't break in, leave it open, and that was it. So I do believe 100% it's the police who was looting this city more than anything else. Not the people of the city. The people of the city was running for their life.
A lot of the people here say they don't feel bad taking this stuff. One, because they need it. But two, they said the police said it was okay. And we actually saw the police. They're in aisle three.
How I'm doing? How you doing?
Hi, what you doing here?
I'm doing my job.
Taking shoes?
No, looking for looters.
Looking for looters? And what do you do when you find them? Because I think
I
see them.
School. That's all I can do with them right now, sir.
They're all around us, though.
That's what I see, including you. What are you doing?
I haven't taken anything, ma'am.
But you're in the store.
Before Katrina, although the police were known, nationally known, for their complete lack of regard for human life and dignity, they didn't face the same kind of attention. And they could act with impunity even if people were watching them.
Last Monday night, I was downtown and I was went to several bars looking for somewhere that had the football game on, and I was getting ready to walk in this bar, the cop was coming out and I asked him if there was a football game. The football game was on. He's like, why don't you go find out for yourself? I was like, all right, dude, I will. You know, I just asked him a question. You got to be a jerk about it. Boom, throws me against the wall. Got arrested, handcuffed. I asked him what I was being arrested for. He said he didn't have to tell me. They said I was being arrested for disturbing the peace and drunk in public. I said, drunk in public? I haven't had any alcohol in me. I said, can I take a breathalyzer test? They said, nope. I spent 2 days in jail without a phone call. I spent 32 hours in the jail without a phone call to let anybody know that I was in there.
And the sun shines on.
That those three police officers that we've identified will be suspended from the department today, and they will be arrested, and will be arrested for simple battery.
When the Army was still more of a presence, we actually had phone numbers of commanding officers with the various armed forces who said, if the cops show up, call us and we'll intervene. For a while, the Army was treating and considered the NOPD a rogue organization because their command and control structures had fallen apart. They hadn't been paid since the storm. One night, they put one of our medical workers in cuffs because he was trying to get their badge numbers and names, which, as public officials, they're supposed to give you. They straight told him, you're in cuffs right now because you violated one of the most sacred of New Orleans laws. Don't be too nosy.
Mm-hmm. We had a youngster to be beaten down right in front of our door. Arrest a 16-year-old kid for stealing ice chest. Some say it was over 10 carloads of police that came here.
Two cops just jumped on my back. I threw them off, and the rest of the cops just piled on my back. They arrested me. They brought me around the corner and beat the living hell out of me.
Say it one more time. I'm gonna knock the fuck out of you. You hear me? Lie one more motherfucking time. Lie one more motherfucking time, huh? Lie.
What's that mean?
Huh?
You wanna boot up?
What, you wanna hit me?
No.
You wanna do something? Now what the fuck were you doing at that house? Don't cry like a little bitch. What house? Why was you doing it at that house? Huh? So you were breaking into somebody's house to get your stuff?
I wasn't. I just gave him my mom.
He's not. He's welcome here.
I don't see crime happening. I just don't see it happening. In fact, I see a level of cooperation that one would expect, especially after a catastrophe, that people look to each other for inspiration, help, you know, food, water, the basics. None of them appear to me to be people who would steal anything from anybody. They're gentle, they need help, they're acting appropriately, their psychology is not one of aggression.
Well, the only crime we have here is being committed by officials, police. I mean, you can document what I'm saying. Police stealing cars, looting from Walmarts, shooting people, you know, doing drugs. They went AWOL with the police cars. You know, our elected officials bringing folk down the river to do businesses while we still sit in this kind of condition. So it's obvious that we're on our own. Our police all need psychiatric help right now. We were trying to rescue, and we had guns put out here, you know. And then all the other police that were invited in to help our police came in like they were coming for the world gang, not for catastrophe. They came like they were preparing for war. And I'm not talking about the military, because the military probably saved my life. They weren't drawing their guns on us. As a matter of fact, the clips weren't even in. And little guy kind of looked like he just told me, he said, Mama D, they want us to keep our clips and our guns and shoot to kill. And we told them we just left our rack. We didn't come home to do that. We came home to save people, as I say.
Chris Montgomery says he'd rather be in Iraq than patrolling American neighborhoods.
It is surreal. Yeah, you never expect to do this in your own country.
New York police asked me how many tricks I turned that day. I mean, I didn't have no scarf on, bro. And I said, ask your mama. She kept counting for both of us. Well, he's getting ready to get out and get aggressive then.
But if you're gonna walk the streets of St. Tammany Parish with dreadlocks and chi-wee hairstyles, then you can expect to be getting a visit from a sheriff's deputy.
You have to look at the thing as a whole. This isn't a violent system here. Anywhere you have a huge disparity in wealth, where you have people with million-dollar homes right next to, two blocks away from people who are scraping the dirt to get by. You're going to have tension. You're going to have violence. It's that disparity that causes that.
Now it's time for us to come together and understand that we're in this pot together. They're always talking about New Orleans is a gumbo. But see, we are gumbo made up of different ingredients, yeah. But those ingredients never gel together.
Hopefully this disaster that happened in Louisiana could be like the Black 9/11. You know, help galvanize the so-called African-American people here to fight all the different fronts that we've been fighting on historically since we hit here, like poor education, poor health care and housing and political prisons and police brutality, that this could be a platform for all that, you know, a legit platform, but not just nationally, but also internationally, too, and poor and oppressed people all over the world. That's my hope, you know. Whether it happened or not, I hope so.
Well, any contributions they need to make, they need to bring them on. Come be a part of this, help us rebuild, because we really have to do it ourselves, baby. Brick by brick, house by house, block by block, neighborhood by neighborhood. We're going to do this. We will not let Mr. Trumps and nobody else who think they're going to do this, they're not going to win this. The spirit of New Orleans is what keeps people here and want people to come here.
I'm here for a year. I just rented an apartment, at least a year. But I have a feeling I'll be here for years.
What happens here is going to happen in San Francisco when the next earthquake hits. Could it happen in anywhere that there is any kind of disaster, whether it's a man-made, whether it's a terrorist strike. Whatever happens here will be mirrored.
You ever been walking down a street on a sidewalk and you're on all this cement and all of a sudden you see a little plant or a little flower blooming out of that cement? You know, and it might stop you in your tracks, and you say, "Well, wow, look at here! How in the world this little plant broke through all that concrete to emerge itself?" And you'll find people that don't even have conscience will walk and see that little plant and walk around it. You know, I mean, for no other, they don't have no reason why they walked around it. Only thing that they could is just that respect. You know, and that's what I would like to see common ground be. Let it be that little area where a person can see that and have that respect. Why? Because that respect is not for common ground. That respect is for hope. And that's what common ground is all about. It's all about restoring hope.